Okay, well, welcome. Today's webinar's title, as you can see there, is Diversifying Your Asset Allocation. Excuse me. I don't know if you guys know that South African investors are limited to less than 1% of the world's economy when they're investing exclusively on the Johannesburg Stock Exchange or the JSE. So there's roughly about 400 shares listed on the JSE, and there's about 40,000 stocks worldwide. You can imagine you're only being exposed to 1%. So by restricting yourself to domestic equities means that you are missing out on an extensive investment or extensive investment opportunities available on global equity markets. Okay. So I know I'm going to be repeating myself, and I'll be coming back to this quite a few times, but today's webinar is all about asset allocation, which is the most important consideration when you're constructing a investment portfolio. So when I say asset allocation, basically it's the asset mix, your decision, what you're investing into. And that depends heavily on four things. Number one, obviously your age, your risk tolerance, your investment objectives, and your investment horizon. And you can see there by the subtitle there, it's history shows that you don't know what the future brings. And that's a quote from a guy called Richard Wagoner Jr. And basically, what we're talking about today is that the idea is asset allocation is a bit of diversification as risk management. So that is what we're talking about. So the very first step that we talk about when we talk about investing. So building on that, he has a quote from Ray Dalio. And his quote says, you should have a strategic asset allocation mix that assumes that you don't know what the future is going to hold. So it's just building on that. What I mean by a strategic asset allocation mix, basically it's an investment portfolio strategy that involves setting in target allocations for various asset classes. And obviously the idea here is to periodically rebalance your portfolio back to its original allocations. And you'll see some slides just now what I mean by that. So this happens when they deviate significantly from the initial settings, and that is obviously due to differing returns on various assets. But I also understand that strategic asset allocation is comparable to a buy and hold strategy, as opposed to a tactical asset allocation, which is more suited to an active trading approach. But saying that both strategic and the tactical asset allocation is based on what they call modern portfolio theory. I'm not going to go into that, so don't get all worried about that. But basically, they both emphasize diversification in order to reduce risk and improve portfolio returns. Okay. So that gives you a bit of context what we're going to talk about today. So what is the current situation? So I'm going to get it a bit lighter here and ask you, call it a rhetorical question or a question that can't be answered really. What would you prefer? Higher risk or lower return? So it's a tough choice for many global investors right now. Now, over the last 10 years, excuse me, global government bonds, the yields have declined significantly from roughly about 8% to about 1%, with some bonds now offering you negative yields. In the past, you know, investors would have invested in global government bonds, and although the returns weren't particularly attractive, they still would have received a real return without taking on risk. So this all changed when the central banks around the world started introducing what we call quantitative easing, cheap money, and deliberately keeping interest rates low. So that left a lot of, I'm calling them investors, but you can call them also asset owners, basically of two choices. If you wanted a return that you had become accustomed to, you needed to move further down the risk curve. That was your first choice. And the second choice, if you didn't want to take on more risk, you have to settle for lower returns. So this is where the paradigm comes in. We talk about a risk return paradigm has shifted. You know, so you don't really have much options. You know, in the past, we used to say risk and reward should rise together. Now, the higher the reward, the higher the potential risk. But obviously, as I mentioned now, the risk return paradigm has shifted. And you can look on the next slide. You know, against this background, a lot of these asset owners have argued that since they're not getting a real return from cash or bonds, it would be prudent to replace the investments with investments in more stable equities. And I'm now focusing on the US market, focusing on specifically the utilities or the telecoms or consumer staples. But, you know, and you can go to Google Finance, that's where I got a lot of my information from. Companies like Unilever, Coca-Cola, Procter & Gamble, these have become very popular investments in the US because they have steady revenues, profits, and dividend yields. It was a great idea at the time if you got there first, but obviously these companies, everybody had the same idea, and they attracted a lot of attention, a lot of capital into these companies. They were fairly priced, then they became expensive, and now they're extremely expensive. And as I say, you can go to Google Finance and look at the P ratios of those companies. Unilever is on a PE of 22.6, Coca-Cola is on 24.25, and Procter Gamble is on 24.18. So you can see my slide here, anything roughly about above 20 PE, you can classify that as expensive. Yes, there have been spikes where it's gone up higher. And you can see anything below, around about 8, we consider cheap. Now, what about the South African market? You know, you can go one step further, and this is where a lot of the foreign investors have saying it. At the same time, many of these asset owners have been arguing that they want to reduce risk, and they've been selling off emerging market funds, and that's obviously South Africa. So specific companies in emerging markets, however, have now become cheaper. But saying that, you can see on the next slide here, that you might find opportunities in emerging markets. I don't know so much about South Africa. The JSE overall, it's looking at the whole market. The PE ratio there is 23.24. The top 40 index, you can see how it's been moving sideways for nearly 3 years in a range. We're around about, 22.24. Mid caps. So this is looking at, the top 100 companies, mid top 40 and the next 60 company, which is what we call the mid caps. The mid cap index there, your PE ratio 26.23. So our market's not even cheap. You know, I believe our market's very, there are pockets where we're overvalued, there are pockets where we're undervalued. I would say the JSE is mainly fairly valued at this point in time. As I say, you might find some opportunities still on mid caps and in small caps. So if you look at the heavyweight blue chip industrial shares, South African heavyweight stocks, Naspers is trading on a PE of 102. Richmond is trading on a PE of 20.95. British American Tobacco, 19.39. And then Aspen is trading at 34.52. So as I say, these are not cheap stocks. So where do we go? Okay. Excuse me. So the current situation for a lot of people, and I saw this article. I saw an article on Fin24, it's written by Skulk Lowe. He's from PhD Wealth. He says, imagine for a moment that Ernie Els Dreyer arrives at next year's SA Open with only one club in his bag. Okay, one club. He's, for example, his Big Bertha driver. I don't know what clubs he uses, but it doesn't matter how good the Big Easy is. It's just there's just no way he's going to be able to win such a big tournament with only one club. So, with every club, or every stroke rather, requires a different club. You need something for the fairway, something for the sand, so you need something for putting. But every stroke needs a different club. So you'll need a set of clubs in order to have a fighting chance of winning a tournament. Now, investments operate in very much the same principle. Because shares as an asset class have delivered the highest returns over the years, it is challenging to convince a lot of investors out there to say to look at other asset classes like bonds and money market and property as investment options or investment alternatives. Now, obviously, today we're focusing mostly on shares and I call it paper assets. Just understand that when we're looking at the risk versus return aspect of these investments, shares may have delivered greater returns. Okay, it has come at a higher investment risk. So taking control of your investment portfolio starts by determining your personal risk profile. So you can see there, I'm talking about one pot of gold. And this was me a few years ago. I remember having all my investments in the share market, be it through RAs, endowments, you name it, the share portfolios. And I've mentioned this before. I read one of Robert Kiyosaki's books called Prophecy way back in 2005, I think it was. And that scared me, and I started moving my money, diversifying it a bit more. But the whole idea is that most people's investments are related to the stock market, as I say, in paper assets. So we're talking about today is diversifying that asset allocation. So what is the ideal situation? What's the ideal position to be in? So, and I spoke about, I mentioned this in last week's webinar, where you want to have different outcomes, different investment objectives or different outcomes for your investments. So, and I came across this thing, again, there's my disclaimer up front. I'm not a financial advisor. I'm not a tax advisor, anything like that. Remember, my objective always with these webinars is for education and for understanding. You know, I want to plant some seeds. I want you to think about it and look at your options and then obviously investigate and research further. But it's vitally important that investors choose the right investment strategy for a specific goal over a time horizon. So I came across this thing, and the first time I've ever been exposed to it, it's what they call goal-based investing, or GBI, also known as outcome-based investment. The idea is that it gets you away from trying to chase investment, the best investment return, and trying to get you to focus more on the most appropriate investment strategy for that investment term. Okay, they talk about investment term for our liability, and the way I understand it, liability is the process of building up an asset or capital. So while growth goal-based investment provides no guarantee of better performance, it does significantly increase your probability of aligning with your investment objectives. And obviously, that helps you also with portfolio construction. When I say portfolio, investment portfolio construction, and ultimately your performance. Now, just understand that, don't misunderstand that, you know, traditional methods have not failed investors. But I also believe that investors are unique and investment strategies should reflect this. So the goal-based investment just makes the process of investing more relatable. I can make it more tangible for me, be it that I'm setting up an investment fund, I'm setting up an emergency fund for various things, car breakdown or some emergency education fund, and I'll be talking about a specific example just now, education fund for your children, a holiday fund, or your retirement fund. But, you know, going back to what I spoke just now about the big pot, one big pot, instead of investing all your money in one big pot and hoping it solves all your financial goals, basically what I'm saying today is just having a goal-based investment strategy. It helps you construct your, call it your investment plan along specific investment strategies for each goal. Okay, so I hope that makes sense. So that, we'll come back to it just now, but you know, the idea that, let's take for example people that are planning to for retirement. You will have a long-term investment horizon, but obviously you'll be fitting your goals into that. Now, what I found is that the best chance of achieving an investment goal is to set it with a specific time frame. And this gives you greater certainty, which you're trying to achieve. Okay, so I hope that makes sense. It all comes down to, you know, if you're investing, for example, for a longer-term retirement, you'll be planning your goals around that and having specific investment plans for that. I'm getting a bit confused here, but if you understand, you want to have mix up or tie up your tangible goals to your investment plan, and that's where the asset allocation comes into it. Okay, so let's talk about asset allocation. In the past, you know, the asset allocation is, call it a implementation of an investment strategy. And the idea here is to balance risk and reward, I mentioned just now. Okay, so this is by adjusting the percentage of each asset in your investment portfolio according to your risk tolerance, your goals, and your investment time frame. So the traditional or the conventional, there were four main, call it asset classes, was equities, you know, stocks, fixed income or bonds, real estate or property, and in cash and equivalents. But understand that they each have different levels of risk and each have different levels of return. And they also behave differently over time. So what is asset class? So if you look at stocks in general, so asset class like stocks or shares, it's a group of securities that exhibit similar characteristics, behave similarly in the marketplace, but also are subject to the same laws and regulations. So that's an asset class. So stocks will be an asset class, bonds will be an asset class, and so on. Okay. The same investment principle, you know, there are some investment principles that professionals that go so far as to even add in commodities as well as other investment types like cryptocurrencies like Bitcoin, and that's becoming more and more popular. The idea is that you want to mix these assets together for diversification purposes, and as I say, the idea is that they reflect different risks and obviously have different characteristics. So that just gives you some background. Saying that, it's very important to also understand that there is no simple formula that will dictate the right asset allocation for each individual. However, if you look at consensus among many financial professionals, the bottom line is that asset allocation is one of the most important decisions that an investor must make. In other words, the selection of the individual securities, or the asset classes, is secondary to the way that the assets are allocated, in other words, to equities, to bonds, to property, and the cash equivalents. Okay, so that's what we're talking about today. So, excuse me, this is I'm not a financial advisor or anything like that. This is one just idea. So, you might have a conservative, call it risk profile. So, yeah, we're talking about allocating maybe 6% to offshore shares, 14% to local stocks. But majority of our funds, 80% of that, you're allocating more to the steadier performance over time with a bit of element of growth. So that's what we're looking at here. Let me just get my cursor in here. Okay. As we're looking at a conservative asset mix. We talk about a balanced mix. So we're allocating slightly bit more to offshore. Obviously more to local stocks, 40% to bonds, but my focus is still on more on the growth side. But I'm also happy to accept more volatility in my portfolio. We move up to the growth now. Remember, we're talking about risk and rewards. The higher the potential rewards, the higher the potential risk. So I'm allocating more funds to offshore, to bonds. To local stocks and less more to bonds and things like that. And we'll talk about these in more detail just now. So my preference is still for growth, but I'm happy for a significant increase in volatility in my portfolio. I'm happy to live with that. And then lastly, aggressive growth asset mix. This is where I'm going for a wide and sometimes sudden volatility. I'm happy to live that. And that's where the long-term investment will fit into your portfolio. Okay. So let me just get rid of that and we go on to the next slide. Okay, when we talk about shares, as I say, historically have provided a greatest return, but as I say, they are prone to more extreme volatility. Our last great stock market crash was back in 2008. That's when the market declined more than 30%. So that's what you're exposed to. You're just having exposure to equities. Bonds, on the other hand, obviously provide far lower return, but they do provide a fixed income stream that is more stable. And then we talk about real assets like commodities and property. They have the same characteristics like shares and bonds, but they also form an important hedge when other markets are not performing well. In other words, they're not correlated. Okay. So let's get into what am I proposing today. Let me get rid of this. Okay. How will we get there? What are we proposing today? Broadly, you know, investors' needs can be split into three categories. Essential needs, your lifestyle ones, and I call it legacy aspirations. Essential needs, this is where you as an investor are seeking a predictable income with real growth to survive. Okay. So, and we'll come back to the information on the slide now. But we're talking about lifestyle ones. This is where we're looking at You want to maximize your existing living standards through a steady wealth accumulation. And then thirdly, legacy aspirations, something very close to my heart is for my children, is to, you want to make a difference for your own descendants or other people's lives. And this is where you require a high growth strategy. So the way I look at it, short term, medium term, intermediate, I try to find something in between there. So when you're first starting out and first started working, I believe your focus should be on building your capital. So you want to go for high growth. You're willing to take on a higher risk. So you're looking for higher returns with more upside potential. And then once you start building up that capital, now we start accumulating more. So we're building on that, getting your money to work harder for you. And ultimately, we get to a stage where it's wealth preservation or wealth protection. Okay. So let's talk about investment philosophy. Now, I've stolen an idea from PSG Asset Management. This is their investment philosophy. And what is the investment philosophy? The way I look at it, it's a guideline or a directional compass. I believe in having an investment philosophy. So the idea, you can go click on the little link down here, takes you through to the latest wealth perspective. But I don't know if you guys are aware that PSG Asset Management, they always talk about the three M's, the moat, the margin of safety, and management. But their main objective, when they're looking at various investment opportunities, they're looking for companies or any asset has more upside than downside potential. So they are, I call them more value investors, but they're looking for attractive valuations. And the idea is that they compare ideas across a range of asset classes as well as call it opportunities. And when I say opportunities in fixed income, local and global shares, but they're looking for the best opportunity that's going to give them the best chance of providing a return, a real return above inflation with the right level of risk. Now, their definition of risk is a probability of permanent capital loss. Okay, on the next slide, you'll see how we tie this together. I'm not ignoring this definition of risk, but you'll see also another definition of risk on the next slide. But their main goal is to have a long-term view when it comes to the investment process as well as the decision-making. And this is what I find cool. They have three basic principles when it comes to the investment philosophy. Number one, they apply their philosophy consistently. They, when it comes to appraising the value of securities, they are conservative. And I also believe in being conservative when you appraise or look at the valuation of a company. And then thirdly, they are contrarian. So when the market is in panic mode, they want to be buying. And when the market when there's euphoria on the market, they want to be selling. Okay, so it goes back to what Warren Buffett says: be fearful when everyone else is greedy, and be greedy when everyone else is fearful. Okay, so going back to what I spoke just now about GBI or outcomes-based investment strategy, yeah, we're targeting investment goals over a set time frame, and the idea, yeah, when we talk about risk, that is a probability of not reaching your desired outcome. Okay, so that's how you can combine the two together. But the idea is that it provides a diverse opportunity to achieve your requirement investment outcome through your portfolio. So it helps you towards achieving your long-term personal and lifestyle goals. That's why I like this approach so much. But it defines your investment principles and performance assessment slightly a bit differently along the lines of your goals. But also, those of you that are financial advisors, I believe it's just easier to connect the advisor and your investment plan that with a strategy that delivers a goal-orientated result. Okay, so let's look at a practical example. One of my goals, for example, you guys know what's happening with universities right now. I've got a daughter in high school, and I'm looking at ahead, and I'm planning for my daughter's education in New Zealand. Now, I was looking at the University of Auckland. She wants to become an educational psychologist. So if I had to pay for my daughter's Bachelor of Education, I'm looking at, I've got us in New Zealand dollars. So I have to start planning now. This is what the fees cost now. I'm anticipating that, and I'm being very conservative. I'm putting on 10% increase. In 5 years' time, 4 years' time, she finishes matric, and I'm going to give her a gap year. But let's say, for example, in year number five, I'm anticipating that her first year undergrad fees is going to be 44,000 New Zealand dollars. Now, at this morning's exchange rate of 9.87, I'm going to round it off to 10 rand to the dollar, to the New Zealand dollar. I'm looking for a first year education being 440,000 rand. If I anticipate her to do post-grad, another, talking about 5 years, I'm ultimately looking at $720,000. Okay, so going back to what I spoke about last week, I'm just putting this in context. In context, what I've been talking about, this goal-based investment plan. So it just makes me realize that I have to really get my money to work hard for me, and I have to find the best investment vehicle. Last week we spoke about the best investment vehicles, and that's what we're going to talk about now. What are my options available to having exposure offshore? So there are five options. So option number one is to buy dollar-denominated unit trusts. So if you're going to a simple, what we call a voluntary investment plan, there are no investment limitations. There's no restrictions. Okay. However, if you are contributing to a pension fund or retirement annuity, that you might have exposure offshore, just understand because of Regulation 28, you will have limitations. You won't be able to take more than 25% offshore. It's there to protect you. Okay, but unit trusts are great for individuals, companies, and unit trust. I'm not talking about the non-discretionary funds. Okay, I'm talking about voluntary funds. With another advantage of going through unit trust, I can go on a monthly debit order, minimum of 500 rand, or a minimum of a lump sum of 20,000. You don't have to repatriate those funds back. You can take your money, leave your money, having exposure offshore and things like that. You don't need a tax clearance certificate. Now, in the presentation just now, I spoke about having exposure to bonds. Now, the easiest way for South Africans to get exposure to bonds is through a unit trust. And this is one of them I'm suggesting here, the PSG Income Fund. Click on that link, it gives you the fact sheets. If you want to have exposure to what I call a rand-denominated offshore fund, you can click on the Global Fund Equity Feeder or the Global Flexible Feeder that gives you more exposure there. Okay, so that's option number one. Option number two, we spoke about it before. By the way, next week we're talking about it in more detail, is a rand-denominated ETP. There's no limitations. You can take as many, you can have exposure to as much as you want offshore. So again, individuals, companies, and trust. With our investment plan, you can have a debit order in place for 300 rand or minimum a lump sum of 1,000. There's no repatriation of funds back to South Africa, and you do not need a tax clearance certificate. Now, Deutsche Bank has been in the news lately. They have a range called DBX trackers. They have exposure to Japan, Europe, USA, UK, and the world. So yes, they might have been in the news. They've got this $14 billion fine in place. But just understand that the bank has to keep their funds separate from the investments. Okay, and then BNP Paribas, they got a lot of ETNs. You can also have exposure to Europe, etc. But those are ETNs. And then the new kid on the block, there are some core shares already, but Grindrod Bank in the process of listing two new ones that have exposure offshore, the S&P 500, which is exposure to top 500 companies in the States, as well as the S&P 500 Global Property. So if you want to have exposure to global property, here's another way of getting exposure offshore. Okay. Just understand with, we talk about the PSG, the ETF investment plan. If you have a stockbroking account with PSG, you can direct some of your capital to these ETFs and obviously invest offshore. You're still investing in rands, and obviously when you sell, those rands comes back, but you're having exposure to those markets offshore. And then the third option is what do we call the single discretionary offshore allowance. This is where you physically want to take your money offshore. This is where you don't want to have your money repatriated back. So with this situation, it's only for individuals. There are minimums. For example, there's a minimum of 100,000. Just makes it, you know, take 100,000 divided by the current exchange rate. You know, you do have limitations where it becomes uneconomical, less than that. Okay, so you don't need any tax credits from the Reserve Bank. However, you do need to register that you take your money offshore. Option number four, that's when you, over and above your single 1 million, your 1 million, you want to take more than that, up to 10 million. Again, the minimum is 100,000. Yeah, you do need a tax clearance certificate. Okay, in this situation, that tax clearance certificate must include a specific SARS logo as well as a specific watermark. And that tax clearance certificate, by the way, you must understand it's only valid for 12 months from the date indicated on the certificate. So that's very, very important. By the way, you can take 1 million rand offshore every single calendar year. Okay. And then if you've exhausted option number three and option number four, we also have option number five, which is the PSG asset swap facility. So there are limitations in the sense that it's limited to PSG's asset swap facility, but understand it's a few billion. But this is ideally for individuals, trusts, companies, and partnerships. So those of you that are involved in investment clubs, this is the only way you can do it, is through the asset swap facility. Again, there are limitations, 5,000 pounds with this morning's exchange rate of 16.73. It's roughly about 83,000. So that's a minimum, but just round off to about 100,000. Remember, with these asset swap facilities, they have to be repatriated back to South Africa in rands. What's great about this, you don't need a tax clearance certificate. Okay. So remember, as I say, I'm not a tax consultant. I'm not a financial advisor. So speak to your tax consultant or your financial advisor. Okay. Just also understand that your investment offshore still forms part of your estate. You are still liable for estate duty in the jurisdiction that you're investing in. But again, as I say, speak to your tax consultant about that. So what are the benefits? Okay. What are the benefits? Why do you want to invest offshore? So we as South Africans know we've been juggling this ball for quite a while. A lot of the political events of the last year obviously has made that decision increasingly more significant. But also remember, our main objective for taking money offshore, remember, we only have 1% of the global GDP here in South Africa. You want to be exposing yourself to greater opportunities. Now, South African companies might be doing okay. They might be great companies, but South African economy, the consumer, as well as obviously the rand, will have impact on growing earnings and obviously the share prices, or trying to predict those share prices makes it a bit more unpredictable. So ultimately, you can say we might have a muted stock market performance within a low growth environment, and obviously that might be affecting your wealth. Okay, so you need to diversify your risk. That's what we're talking about today. So I always say diversifying your risk on the one hand, but also to hedge your opportunities. Okay, so please understand, yes, we talk about the rand depreciation. Historically, the rand has depreciated roughly about 6% against our trading partners. But we saw last year where the rand depreciated more than 30%. So, you know, if you're looking at the rand, it has devalued it faster than you think, especially against the dollar and the pound and things like that. Just understand, when we're talking about investing offshore, it's not about the rand. Okay. It's gaining exposure to opportunities offshore. So that's what I'm talking about here. Investment opportunities not available here in South Africa. So it's getting exposure, I always say getting exposure to sectors not available in South Africa, the technology sector, the biotechnology sector. There are banks and even the big names like the Starbucks and the McDonald's and things like that. My background is that some of you guys might know is the hospitality industry. So getting exposure to that, that's what excites me. But remember, my main objective for investing offshore is geographic diversification. But time back to what I was talking about just now, but goal-based investments. You want to be saving money for future expenses, be it your children's education at foreign universities, or that you want to travel extensively, or that you want to retire offshore. my main objective here is, you know, it's, as far for some of you that want to hedge because of that you fear political or social unrest, I like to have a plan B in place. Especially if you've got young children like myself, I'm worried about their financial future or their future. So I, just in case, I like to have a plan B. And that's where I'm coming from. Putting my head my cards on the table here. So, excuse me. You might have some questions. I anticipate those questions. What are the disadvantages of investing offshore? Yes, you must understand you are dealing with volatile markets and volatile currencies. But also remember, global markets can be rather daunting, especially if you're a novice investor. Start to crawl before you walk, before you run. Start locally before you go global. So there's a lot of, especially when you look at global markets, a lot of events that are unknown to the individual investor. Be aware that obviously you need to increase your knowledge or educate yourself first. Gain the knowledge and experience first. You know, understand what the investment vehicle is about and before you start going offshore. But also remember, going offshore, I believe you're looking at higher appetite for risk. You need more time to watch the markets. And I say, yeah, you need expert knowledge of the markets as well as the trading processes. Remember, it's not for everyone. You need a minimum, at least 100,000 to go offshore. Okay. What are the costs? And this is also very important. Brokerage fees, we're talking about 1% of a minimum 25 pounds converted back to the market currency. There's a carrier custody fee of 13 pounds. There's stamp duty. There's what they call a PTM levy, which stands for panel of takeovers and mergers. This is mainly obviously in the UK. There's exchange conversion fee. So there's a lot of fees involved. So be aware of that too. Okay. So these are some of the things you need to consider. Just to make it lighter before I end up and answer your questions, do you guys know the oldest stock exchange was started in Belgium way back in 1460? I did not know that when I came across this. The New York Stock Exchange is the largest stock exchange in the world, and that was established way back in 1792. However, it's not the oldest. When we talk about the U.S. markets, the oldest is the Philadelphia Stock Exchange, which was created 2 years before the New York Stock Exchange. What I found was also interesting was the New York Stock Exchange is the most traditional. Now, traders cannot enter the floor without wearing a suit or tie. I did not know that. And we're now at the tail end of October, but two of the worst stock market crashes have occurred in October. A lot of the stockbrokers consider October as the jinxed month. Okay. Until 16 years ago, the New York Stock Exchange still expressed prices in fractions before they moved over to decimal places. A decimal we're using at the moment. Okay. It was interesting that the New York Stock Exchange lagged the London Stock Exchange and the Paris Stock Exchange, moving away from fractions. The first company listed on the New York Stock Exchange was a bank, and it was the Bank of New York way back in 1792. And I also found this interesting. The NASDAQ Stock Exchange was started in 1971. And remember, the NASDAQ Stock Exchange consists mainly of technology stocks. Imagine way back in 1971, that's where a lot of investors were focusing on already, on technology stocks. So that does it. I just wanted to lighten up before I answer your questions. So let's see what kind of questions you guys have got today. Cool. Let me go on here. Wow, a lot of questions. Awesome. Okay. Tony, your feelings on physical gold coins for the ultimate inflation and currency projection. Tony, yes, I do physically have exposure to gold, not through ETFs. I physically own gold. It's not so much for gold, through Kruger Rands and that, but I do use things called Carat Bars. It's a German company in Germany that holds gold for me. I believe I always said 5% of your money in physical gold. So yeah. 3%, it's up to you, Tony. Local shares include Rand Edge shares. Do you count these as offshore? No, I personally don't look at it as offshore because they're still locally. And also, by the way, those Rand Edge stocks, especially the industrial stocks, Valley, I believe they're very expensive. I referred to you just now about Bats and Richemont and those kind of companies, also the Aspens. But when I talk about offshore, it's physical companies that are listed offshore. So that's if you don't have exposure offshore. That's one of the easiest ways to get offshore if you want to have that is through a Randian stock. But I personally look at offshore as listed offshore in another stock market. What is ideal? This is a question from Milan Jaber. What is ideal to buy PE in local markets and what is not? Our market is expensive. Anything above 20, very similar to the S&P 500. Anything below 8 would be cheap on the local market. So our market, we're trading roughly about 20. Our market, as I say, are fairly valued. So difficult question to answer right now. As I say, there are pockets of value, but our general market, I would say the market is cheap. Where do you buy ETPs via the PSG online platform? As I say, you can buy it as a normal share if you've got a normal trading account in Milan. It trades normal as a share. Or you can buy it through the investment plan, and that's where you open up a separate account. Okay. Where do you start with bonds? As I say, the easiest way to get involved in bonds is through a unit trust, and the one I'm suggesting there is a PSG income fund. Okay. What is considered max offshore percentage of total asset? Wow, that's difficult to answer. Remember, obviously, if you got RAs and things like that, max offshore, you're restricted to 25 anyway with the regulation 28. As much as you can, take it offshore if you can. The biggest thing there, as I say, is time analyzing those markets and things like that. So I have a separate portfolio for investing offshore. Joseph, would you invest in mining shares at this moment? Me personally, I've always looked at gold and platinum mining stocks as a trading. I use them a lot for trading, especially on single stocks and CFDs. I personally won't have them in an investment portfolio. My investment portfolio is buy and hold. So because of the volatility, I won't have it like that. If I do want to have exposure to any mining stocks in a long-term portfolio, I would go ETF route, be it the Satrix Resi or anything like that. I know the Satrix Resi, the top 10 resource stocks, might only have one or two gold or platinum stocks in it, mainly exposed to resource stocks. Joseph, me personally, as I say, I view mining stocks as mainly as a trading tool. Mike, offshore requires expert knowledge. I agree. You're right. How does one minimize this risk if you don't have the time to get this expertise and watch the markets? Mike, I find the best way to do that is open up an offshore account. Remember, again, the limitations is 100,000. And then get involved with ETPs, exchange-traded funds, having exposure to certain sectors. So that's what I suggest you do. Remember, and I'll be talking about this in more detail in next week's webinar. We're talking about exchange-traded funds, active versus passive investment. Yeah, in South Africa, there's still room for the active investor. Information is not disseminated at the same time, so you can take advantage of discrepancies in the market. Whereas overseas, we're talking about efficient market, a market being very efficient. Instead of trying to beat the index, buy the index, and that's one way of doing it is buying an ETF, especially someone that hasn't got the knowledge or hasn't got the time. So, Mike, I hope that answers your question. But tune in to next week's webinar. Okay. So, guys, look like that's all the questions. Cool. Okay, great. Thanks for all the questions. Let's move on quickly. So, in conclusion, what I want to gain from this presentation, just understand. We're talking about asset allocation. My objective is to diversify geographically. If you look at offshore, remember, we're talking about 35 exchanges. And remember, in this context, we're talking mainly about paper assets, be it through shares, unit trust, ETPs, or offshore shares. Okay. But main objective here by investing offshore is having exposure to industries not available here in South Africa, or sectors not available here in South Africa, or shares not available in South Africa. And that's what gets me excited about it. So unfortunately, the best source of information on all these companies, I believe, is Google Finance. You can look at Yahoo Finance too. I, in the past, have used a program called, gone blank now. I've gone blank. It's a technical analysis program that combines it with the fundamentals. Dr. David Paul is a guy here in South Africa. Ah, can't blank. Ah, yeah. Sorry, guys. Okay. what's your next steps? If you haven't got an offshore account yet and you feel that you want to take more than 100,000 offshore, please consider that. But remember, there are other options, as I mentioned in the slide, you're having exposure through unit trusts or ETPs. Okay, remember the PDF and the recording will be sent out hopefully in the next day or so. If you have any questions, please contact our sales desk on wealth@phg.co.za, and there's the direct number as such. From my side, thank you very, very much for being on this webinar. There's the upcoming webinars for November. Next week, as I say, we're talking about exchange traded funds. Next week, second week in November. What causes the share price to move up and down? Yes, we're talking about supply and demand, but it's people's perception about the company's earnings, which is more important. How do you supplement your retirement funds, retirement savings, tax efficient? How do you benefit from market volatility? On the 30th and the 7th of December, I'll be overseas. I'm going to Las Vegas for a big conference. So those 2 weeks, I've got colleagues of mine doing it. It's more talking about trading and technical analysis. So tune into that. But obviously, I'll be here for the whole of November still. Okay. There's my email address. Any guys got any queries that anything that I didn't that came up in the presentation that you didn't have a chance to answer or me to write the question, please drop me an email. But guys, from my side, thank you very much for being on this webinar again. And there's my disclaimer. Everything I said in this presentation is for educational purposes only. I'm not advocating any strategy. I'm planting some seeds. Do your own homework and things like that. But remember, it's education and understanding. That is my main objective. But from my side, thanks very much for being on this webinar. Until next week, all the best. Bye for now.